the largest warships in the history of the United Kingdom, the pinnacle of high technology and the pride of the state, and also the object of ridicule, the center of political scandals, and the great pain of the Royal Navy. Today we will get acquainted with ships that make you admire their mighty appearance and ask the question, how did so many serious, experienced, and smart people manage to make so many mistakes? The Queen Elizabeth class is on the horizon. The United Kingdom has had naval aviation since its inception. First, it was seaplanes launched from cruisers, and then carrier-based aircraft operating on the first aircraft carriers, born in the fires of the First World War. And then, after almost 100 years of proud service, they were faced with heated debate. Some said that the time of aircraft carriers in the Royal Navy was over, that this weapon was too complex and expensive, and the country should redirect resources to more affordable options. Others responded that naval aviation was the most important factor in projecting power, and it could not be abandoned. The experience of the Falklands War was not forgotten. Who knows how it would have ended if there had been no aircraft carriers. Besides, Great Britain is the mistress of the seas. At least it was. National pride did not give it rest. In the end, the proponents of continuing the century-old tradition won. It was decided that when the veteran Invincible class ships finished their career, they would be replaced by two new ships, the minimum required to maintain constant readiness. While one was being serviced, the other could be at sea. The design of new aircraft carriers immediately faced the question, how will it work with aircraft? The British Navy used the STOVL scheme, when the aircraft performs a short takeoff from a skyjump and lands on the deck vertically. This scheme allows for relatively compact ships, does not require complex equipment, and is cheaper, which is why it is popular. The problem with the scheme is its limitations. Only STOVL planes and helicopters can work with it. On the Invincible aircraft carriers, these were the legendary Sea Harriers. However, the Harrier was outdated, and at first there was no worthy replacement for it. The second popular scheme is the so-called CATOBAR, when aircraft take off with the support of catapults on a flat deck and land clinging to the arresting gear cables. This scheme is more efficient, more different aircraft can work with it, which can be heavier, up to all sorts of turboprop transports. A side effect is that such aircraft carriers have serious dimensions, angled flight decks, and special equipment, which is why they are very expensive. Nowadays, most of these ships are supercarriers of the United States Navy, as well as the French Charles de Gaulle and the Chinese Fujian. For London, this was the dilemma of the century, because the Royal Navy wanted two ships, but it did not have the budgets of Washington and Beijing. Paris, with its similar economy, managed only one ship. The answer to this dilemma was the initiation of the Joint Strike Fighter program in the United States, which, among other things, included the creation of the F-35 Lightning II in version B, which can land vertically, similar to the Harrier but of the fifth generation, with all the perks. As a result, it was decided to build aircraft carriers with a STOVL design for the F-35B. This way, it was possible to save money and get two ships. The plan was good, at least on paper. The program was fully initiated in 2008 with BAE Systems as the prime contractor. This was the start of creation of a new class of British aircraft carriers, Queen Elizabeth. The construction involved 4 companies, 90 contractors, and 10,000 people at 7 shipyards, a real mega project. The lead ship, HMS Queen Elizabeth, was laid down in 2009. The second one, HMS Prince of Wales, began to be assembled in 2011. The war of aircraft deployment schemes did not subside even after the ships began to be born in the shipyards. The supporters of the STOVL scheme with F-35B fighters pressed for the cheapness of implementation compared to the extremely expensive CATOBAR scheme. And they were right. American aircraft carriers are frightening not only with their combat power, but also with their monstrous cost. And one could point to the neighbors on the other side of the channel. Look, the French built an aircraft carrier. Full-fledged, large, nuclear, cool. But what's the point of all this in situations when the fleet needs its flagship, and the flagship with all its coolness is in the dock for maintenance? We will make a cheaper project. Yes, with reduced functionality, but in return we will have two ships with constant combat readiness. But the financial ground under their arguments soon became shaky. At the program's initiation, it was thought that it would cost £3.9 billion. For two large aircraft carriers, this was really great. But that figure then rose to £4.1 billion, and with the economic crisis of 2008, construction was hit by delays that swelled the budget to £5.9 billion, which is almost $9.5 billion. This reopened the debate with renewed vigor. Now the critics were attacking, believing that the Royal Navy would receive two aircraft carriers cut in functionality for a huge amount of money. There were demands to convert them, remove the skyjumps, install catapults and arresting gear, and buy the F-35Cs, normal carrier-based fighters with better performance and lower price. Or the second option, to stop spending so much money on potentially ineffective ships and abandon the construction of, at least, Prince of Wales. But the fleet by that time was trapped. Calculations showed that the conversion of the ships, although possible, would be an extremely expensive project. Even more iconic was the situation with the cancellation. Revising the contracts and stopping the construction would cost the government almost the same amount of money as completing the ship. In the end, it was decided to stay on the previous track, keep the STOVL scheme, complete both ships, and then decide what to do next. Lease Prince of Wales, sell it, or simply put it in storage. A new ship. Ah, and the plans were so good. Despite all the difficulties and disputes, the construction of the lead ship was carried out at a fairly rapid pace. Already in 2014, it was launched. The aircraft carrier Queen Elizabeth was christened by Queen Elizabeth II. Prince of Wales, with all its torments, was launched only in 2017. By that time, the issue of its service had already become political, and the country's leadership announced that it would not give the ship to anyone, and both aircraft carriers would serve Her Majesty in full. In fact, this is what happened. Now they are operational in the Navy. And despite all the controversy, the Queen Elizabeth-class aircraft carriers remain impressive. The 284 meters long steel behemoths displace a whopping 80,000 tons. More than three times the size of the old Invincible class, almost twice the size of the Charles de Gaulle, roughly the size of China's Fujian, and only 20% smaller than the Ford. In a remarkable achievement of British industry, the Queen Elizabeth class are the largest warships ever to fly the Royal Navy flag. At 73 meters wide, the aircraft carriers have a very impressive deck, which, given its size, is limited to just one runway. With the STOVL configuration, aircraft land vertically and do not need a second, deflected runway. The second nuance that we see right away is the main feature of Queen Elizabeth, two deck superstructures. The island in front is used for control and navigation of the ship. The island in the back is the flight control center. Such an unusual design has its advantages: redundancy of systems, separation of radars, compactness, better visibility, and so on. But the reason for such a design is hidden under them. The ship is equipped with two isolated power plants that work in parallel. Such redundancy guarantees the operability of the systems in case of damage and increases survivability. The nuance is that the widely separated power plants also have widely separated air supply and exhaust channels, pipes. They are tied to the superstructure, and in the case of a single design, it would have turned out very large. But here, the British decided to cheat and came up with this scheme, with two superstructures and free space between them. The ship's power plant is not nuclear. Again, too expensive. Instead of a reactor, it has a pair of Rolls-Royce Marine Trent MT-30 gas turbine generators with a capacity of 36 megawatts each, the marine relatives of the Rolls-Royce Trent aircraft engines, plus four diesel generators of 9 and 11 megawatts. All this power provides electricity for both the ship's systems and four engines of 27,000 horsepower connected to two propellers. The power plant allows the ship to accelerate to a speed of 25 knots and provides a range of 10,000 miles. Not the best performance of nuclear aircraft carriers, but not bad either. The ship's crew is about 680 people. Not a bad progress in the field of automation and optimization of work. Only invincible aircraft carriers, which, I repeat, are 3 times smaller, the crew was about the same. There are also a lot of air wing personnel here, about 900 people. Plus, if necessary, up to 900 Marines can be accommodated. Queen Elizabeth's crowning glory is her Artisan 3D active electronically scanned array radars. The radars are said to be able to track up to 1,000 targets at ranges of up to 250 miles, making them among the most powerful in their class and turning the ship into an effective floating headquarters. The armament includes 3 Phalanx CIWS anti-aircraft artillery systems, 4 30mm DS-30M cannons, and 6 12.7mm Browning machine guns. And this is another point of complaint: too modest armament. Yes, aircraft carriers have never been distinguished by epic arsenals, but here there are not even the most basic missile air defense systems. This makes them extremely vulnerable and dependent on escort, with which the Royal Navy also has problems. There are not enough destroyers, frigates, and support ships, to the point that carrier strike groups are forced to include allied ships, which can have a negative effect on their independence. The Queen Elizabeth's air wing can vary greatly depending on the mission, from 40 for normal missions to 72 if trouble is expected. The core of the air wing is, as already mentioned, the F-35B short takeoff and vertical landing fighters, up to 36 aircraft, twice as many as on the invincible aircraft carriers, and sufficient to successfully conduct a wide range of operations. That's all of the planes, the drawback of the STOVL scheme. However, there are a lot of helicopters. The Merlin HM2, a local version of the Augusta Westland AW101, both in the purely transport version and in the Crow Nest version, airborne early warning helicopters. The AW-159 Wildcat, plus the classics, the Chinook and Apache helicopters, and if necessary, the V-22 Osprey tiltrotors. Of course, the ship has a hangar measuring 155 by 33.5 meters. To deliver equipment between the hangar and the deck, 2 large elevators are used, located behind the first and second superstructures. From the description of the air wing, one can conclude that the Queen Elizabeth aircraft carriers are indeed formidable weapons, even taking into account the limitations. And if we talk exclusively about the ships, that can be true. Except that with the planes, things did not go so well. The problems here were pressing from 2 sides at once. On the one hand, the F-35 program was facing many difficulties, which led to both increased costs of the aircraft and delays in deliveries. On the other hand, the British military's purchases of aircraft were constantly faced with a shortage of funding, which forced them to reduce expenses. Initially, it was planned to purchase an impressive batch of more than 100 F-35B for 2 aircraft carriers, which could completely cover the ship's needs as well as provide reserves and training. But over time, the planned number was reduced and delivery times were extended. Soon, there were 80 of them to form 4 squadrons. Then there were 3 squadrons, and the number of planes on board each aircraft carrier, instead of 36, began to vary between 12 and 24. As of 2025, the air wing is about 34 planes for 2 aircraft carriers. That is, the ships are sailing practically half empty, and the situation apparently will continue for quite a long time. Meanwhile, the combat performance of the F-35B was disappointing. This version is not only more complex and expensive than the regular naval F-35C, but also has a shorter range and combat load, both on takeoff and landing. There are often situations when a fighter has to drop unused bombs into the sea simply because it will not be able to land vertically with them. The sailors even came up with a special method of not vertical, but short, shipborne rolling vertical landing, when the aircraft switches to vertical engine mode but continues horizontal flight at low speed, which increases lift, and after landing it breaks through wheels without arresting gear. Many consider one of the solutions to the problem of the air wing's functionality to be its expansion by drones, which, being lighter and more compact, will be able to operate on aircraft carriers. The fleet is still learning how to work with them, developing several of its own programs and testing American devices. But experts and military circles continue to voice opinions that these are all some kind of crutches, and the STOVL aircraft are not efficient enough. Yes, at one time, Harriers brought the Royal Navy many victories, but that was a long time ago, and now times are different. Yes, the F-35Bs are also supplied to the US armed forces, but there they act only as support and do not claim the main roles. The Queen Elizabeth class finds itself in a very strange position. In terms of functionality, it is close to small aircraft carriers or helicopter carriers, which are quite good for their roles. But in terms of size, complexity and cost, it should, in theory, be almost at the level of supercarriers, and this is hardly true. And either it needs to be rebuilt, or we must accept that the two main ships of the country are in a way handicapped. Apparently, the Royal Navy has come to the conclusion that aircraft carriers will, sooner or later, have to be modified to the classic scheme with catapults and arresting gears. In 2021, it became known that they are considering the possibility of modifying aircraft carriers, in one way or another. So some kind of restructuring will probably happen. Otherwise, the Queen Elizabeth class risks securing the title of unsuccessful flagships with unrealized potential. Subscribe to the channel so as not to miss new stories, marine or otherwise. There are still a lot of interesting things on the horizon.